I'm okay. Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Jai Gopi Janavallabha Kirivar Hare Jai Jai Gopi Janavallabha Kirivar Hare Jai Kiri Yasodanandana Raja Janahanjanaya Yasodanandana Raja Janahanjanaya Jammuna Dhirahavana Jamura Tira Havana Chahi Jamuna Jai Havana Bhagavan Jai Havana Kunjabi Jai Radham Madhava Kunjabi Hare Kunjabi Jai Gopi Janavallabha Girivara Hare Jai Gopi Jamuna Dhira Jamuna Dhira Jamuna Dhira Jamuna Dhira Jamuna Dhira Jai Radham Madhava Kunjabi Hare Kunjabi Jai Radham Madhava Kunjabi Hare Jai Radham Madhava Kunjabi Hare Hey Kunjabi Thank you. Oh, Pepperande!
Jai Om Vishnu Pad Paramahans Parivaja Kachaya Stotra Satrashi Sivamista Vangas. A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. ISKCON founder Acharya, His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Sri Harinam Sankirtan Ki Jai. Sri Sri Kishore Kishori Ki Jai. Gaur Premanandi Hari Hari Bol Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Maharani Ki Jai. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. Glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Get warmed up a little bit. It's feeling kind of cold, so we needed to do something. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So before we begin chanting the verse on the board, I'd just like to take a few minutes and explain a little bit about what will be presented within the next six sessions, including this one. So on the request of our glorious and very wonderful temple president, he requested this topic, guru-disciple relationship. And when I thought about it, I realized it's one of the most important topics, one of the most extensive topics, one of the most hard to really understand completely topics, not hard to understand completely, impossible, and I think one of the most fundamental topics in everything we do in Krishna consciousness. Fundamental means the basis of everything else. So, based on this particular subject matter, we'll discuss it from different angles, and we try to make it a little interactive in certain parts. So, this first session is, what is a spiritual master, or what is a guru? More correctly, what is a guru? Why do we need a guru? How the guru is one. How the guru is one, there is only one guru. And how the guru is different. And how the guru is one and different simultaneously. So this will be the first topic, along with, what is not a guru? And this, in this day and age, we really need to explore what is not a guru before we can understand fully what is a spiritual master. Because the age we live in, there are a lot of persons who present themselves in this particular position. So there is, just like there are qualities and characteristics of a particular item, and that makes that item, what we say, describable and distinctible, and also functionable. So in the same way, a guru has qualities, characteristics, activities, and not just one who may present themselves as a teacher of transcendental knowledge. So that's part of this first lesson. And we'll the second session, which begins at 11 o'clock today, what are the qualifications of a bona fide spiritual master? So I noticed in putting together this little seminar, what is a guru and what is qualifications sort of overlap slightly. So I'm just going to briefly go into what is a guru in this first session and then get into the different aspects of guru. And then in the second session, we'll talk about the qualifications of a spiritual master, and that'll be more extensive. The third session will be, what are the qualifications of a disciple and an aspiring disciple? I think you should not miss that one. If you have something to do at that time, see if you can try to adjust it, because that'll probably, as far as all of you are concerned, be one of the most important things, because there's a lot of misconception what it means to be a disciple. Or not only misconceptions, but what we say, assumptions. Assumptions. So that's the third session. And tonight at 5:30, there'll be a Nam Yajna starting, and then there'll be some of our local kirtan singers. If anyone who is of that quality and caliber, come and see me, and we can include you in the spot to lead kirtan. So that'll be from 5:30 to 8, so just constant kirtan, 2.5 hours. And tomorrow we'll talk about the first session will be some of the dynamics of guru-disciple relationship, along with stories that kind of illustrate that relationship and take away from that relationship. And the next session, which is the next to the last section, is very important also. The disqualifications of a disciple. And that's based on one verse from the sixth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, sixth canto, seventh chapter, verse number 15, if you want to look it up. It's also very important to know what you shouldn't be like. It's nice to know what you should be. And then the last session, which will be the Sunday feast lecture tomorrow night, will describe the different understandings of the Guru Vandanam prayer, the one we just sing every day, the prayer to the spiritual master. Srila Prabhupada gave a class in Mayapur in 1976, and he went through each line by line, explaining what that line, those meanings of those lines are. So that'll be the Sunday feast lecture. We'll talk about Guru Vandanam prayer. So that's the entire seminar. So check the times, 11 o'clock today. I think the second session is at 3:30 today to 5:30. Okay, so that's just a summation of what's about to happen. So I chose one verse from the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam to help us enter into the mood of, you know, what is a guru? And also a little bit about a disciple. This is a very popular verse among Srila Prabhupada's quotations. He quoted it quite often like that. So, tasmad gurum prapadyetad. Tasmad gurum papadhyetahar jignasu sreya uttamam sabde parecha nishnatmam parecha nishnatam brahma upasrayasrayam tasman gurum papadhyetahar Jigyasu Sreya Uttamam Sabde Parecha Nishnatam Brahma Upasrayasrayam Tasman Gurum Papadyetaha Jigyasu Sreya Uttamam Sabde parecha nishnatam Brahma upasrayasrayam. Anyone? ladies. Tadishnatam. So, translation, therefore, any person who seriously desires real happiness must seek a bona fide spiritual master and take shelter of him by initiation. The qualification of a bona fide guru is that he has realized the conclusions of the scriptures by deliberation and is able to convince others of these conclusions. Such great personalities who have taken shelter of the Supreme Godhead, leaving aside all material considerations, should be understood to be bona fide spiritual masters. Om Agyan Timirandasya Gyanajana Salakaya Chaksu Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobitam Staptitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadanti Swapadantikam Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sivasati Gaur Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. So this verse, there's two, what we say, essential points. The point is, people are desiring real happiness. So happiness means coming in contact with your essence, yourself. You can't be happy unless you're acting according to your nature. And we're not talking about our acquired nature, we're talking about our eternal nature. Our eternal nature is a spiritual being. So happiness exists unlimitedly in connection with the our original source, and that is Krishna. And that's explained throughout the Shastras, that the living entity is not the material body, but is part and parcel of Krishna eternally. Jivair Sarupai Krishnair Nityadas. This is fundamental, but also very essential to understand any other knowledge. That's why in the very beginning of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna dealt with this subject first. What is the difference between you and your body? To know the difference, to act, what we say, according to one's spiritual nature, and to achieve the goal of life. Now, throughout the Shastras, there are only three main subjects. If you go through all Vedic literatures, you'll find that all literatures are categorized, in three main subjects: sambandha, abhideya, prayojana. Each of these subject matters includes many, many subtopics. In fact, sambandha means to come in contact with the process of spiritual elevation. And what are those subjects that include coming in contact with the spiritual process? Abhideya means to act according to one's spiritual nature and engage in devotional service. What are those subjects that cover that? And the last and the smallest of all the categories, prayojana. Prayojana means ultimately one's ultimate benefit. Or, to put it more simple, to develop love of God. And that's the smallest of all category, and that's the conclusion of all the other activities, to develop love for Krishna. That is the actual goal of all spiritual practices, bona fide spiritual practices. So the first category, sambandham, includes a subject matter of what we're going to be talking about. But before we can get to abhideya, which is execution of our devotional service, we have to connect ourselves with the process through Krishna in the form of Krishna's representative, the bona fide spiritual master. So what is the spiritual master? What are the activities of the spiritual master? What are my duties in relationship to the spiritual master? These all fall into the category of sambandha, which is the biggest category. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur has written Vinod Vaibhava. Vaibhava Vinod. It's two volumes that have been published describing all these categories and the subcategories in detail with questions. In fact, everything is questions and answers, the whole thing. So if you have time, it'd be good to look it up and find out what makes up devotional service. It's quite full with spiritual activities. So this verse here is explaining what is a spiritual master. Now, there is a popular saying within secular society, they use the word guru. Now, the popularity is someone who is a teacher in a particular field, like, you know, a sports guru, or what else? I don't know. Health guru, yeah, doctor. In other words, pick a secular topic, and there is an outstanding person in that field that would be called guru. That's the popular thing. That's not correct. It's just something that has filtered into mainstream society. They took the word guru, knowing it means teacher, and has applied it in a very carte blanche way, which has no real meaning. That's not a guru. So we want to eliminate the popularity or the so-called pretentious ideas of what is guru. Second, there is what is naturally a guru or guru by nature, such as a tree. A tree teaches us what? Tolerance. Yeah, so a tree is naturally a guru because it teaches a certain principle. So what is a guru in the category of nature is given in different examples like that. A dog teaches faithfulness. A tree teaches tolerance. Like that. So that is another definition that have been applied to the word guru. That is not wrong. It's a little better than the previous one, but it doesn't really give you the complete understanding of what guru is. Guru, in the real, in the perfect, guru means one who is heavy with knowledge. And that's the actual definition of spiritual personality or spiritual master, one who is heavy with knowledge. The word guru means weighty. And if you take a guru and put him on one side of the scale, and you put all the knowledge on the other side of the scale, the guru is heavier. Because he knows and can transmit transcendental knowledge into the hearts of others through both his practice and through his words like that. So that's a definition of a guru. And I'll give you a little definition from Srila Prabhupada. Perfectly, standard knowledge. Standard knowledge is received through a system called parampara, disciplic succession. Therefore, it said strotiyam. Strotiyam means one who has heard from the parampara system. Strotiyam. And the result is brahmanishtam. Strotiyam brahmanishtam. He who is firmly fixed up in the service of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So the result of transcendental knowledge is one becomes fixed in the service of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that's a somewhat slight description of what a spiritual teacher is. We'll get into the qualifications and characteristics and activities of a guru in the second session. But just wanted to give you a little understanding. Why do we need a guru? So, Prabhupada's words, coming from Bhagavad Gita, chapter 2, verse number 7, purport. Now, this is very important to understand, because a lot of people say, well, you don't need a guru. Our relationship with God is direct, right? I am part and parcel of God. Therefore, why should someone be in between? I mean, it's an argument, and it's a quite, what we say, often heard argument, especially in India. And I have been many times come face to face with persons who reject the idea of a spiritual teacher like that and say it's just something that you can dispense with. It might be nice to have a guru, he can help you, but it's optional. You can do it. But here's Prabhupada's statement. By nature's own way, the complete system of material activities is a source of complexity for everyone. In every step there is complexity, and therefore it behooves one to approach a bona fide spiritual master who can give one proper guidance for executing the purpose of life. So we say that material energy is endlessly mutable. What does mutable mean? Mutable means changeable. Things are always, there's one thing you can say about the material energy. It always, the one constant about the material energy, and that it's always changing. Change is the only constant in the material world. As everything else is temporary. The only thing constant is change. Interesting. Mm-hmm. So how will one be able to understand a science that is not understood by the gross or subtle senses? Something that is beyond the reach of the senses. Krishna is a hoksaja. One cannot see Krishna. One cannot, you know, directly connect with Krishna through one's mind, senses, intelligence, or even imagination. Krishna remains transcendental. He is, what is it, Brahma Bhuta. Prasannatma, no, I'm sorry, that's not, what is that verse? Can't think of the verse. But the point is that Krishna is not within the material energy. So the mind and senses, Atasi Krishna Namari, Nabhavetrayam Indriya, Sevamukhihi Jivado, Swayameva Spuratyada. Atasi Krishna, that Krishna is beyond the reach of the material mind, senses, everything. So how, when we're so conditioned to think in terms of the three-dimensional world, which is length, breadth, and width, can you understand something that is not within that realm? Therefore, the senses and mind falls short of understanding the nature of transcendence. Transcendence can only be revealed. And then when it's revealed, it's understood. In other words, you can't go up to the Supreme. The Supreme has to come down to you. And there's nothing you can do through your intellect, senses, mind, to bring the Supreme down. Therefore, there's only one way to connect with the Supreme, and that is when the Supreme becomes pleased with you, he reveals himself through to you in various ways, through the mind, through the senses, through the intelligence, and through your life's activities. And so, therefore, someone has to connect you with the Supreme. And that is the purpose why we need a spiritual master. Otherwise, you know, Prabhupada would also say that, you know, it's like if you want to make an appointment with the president, He just can't walk into his office and say, you know, I'm here. You got to see his secretary. And you have to wait, too. And then everything has to be arranged. And that's just an important person in this world. How about the president, who is the controller of all the presidents? Or Prabhupada would say the king of kings. You know, his office you can't crash into. He has to somehow or other be gracious to allow you his darshan or his personal presence. Therefore, if you know somebody who's really close to the president, that helps, right? Or if you know somebody who's really close to God, then you just take, well, you know, I'll make that person my friend and he can get me in, right? We do that nowadays, right? It's like I travel on British Airways when I come. And there's a lady who works for British Airways and she's a devotee and she, you know, just pushes me right through the line and I get, you know, I get all kinds of perks because of her, you know, because she's one of the employees of British Airways. So it's nice, you know, to have somebody like that. You don't have to go through all the rigmarole of, you know, and all the hassles of waiting. So when you know somebody that's connected with something that you're trying to achieve, it makes things easier. It makes things not easier, it makes things possible. So that's the spiritual master. So that we need a guru, otherwise, as this verse says, we will continue to simply be on the platform of the mind. And what is the mind? I like, I don't like. I like, I don't like. I like, I don't like. And a like and don't like is not constant. I like it today, I don't like it tomorrow. So even the likes become the don't likes, and the don't likes become the likes. Right? Because that's the nature of the mind. It's always changing, always changing, always changing. So therefore, we are what we say in need of assistance. Otherwise, there's no question of approaching the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And Prabhupada would often say, you know, people say, in this world, if I want to learn a particular art, particular talent, I approach a teacher. Well, some people say, well, I'll just read the books. All right, so you want to become a doctor, so you read the medical books, and then you put your shingle out. I'm a doctor. How many? You'll have one patient, and after he goes out, he'll tell everybody never to come to you again, right? Because you're not qualified simply by reading medical books. You have to get the authorization of the medical college, and therefore you have to take the sessions and the lessons and show yourself in terms of the qualifications. So that's the position of the spiritual master. He provides the qualifications for you to achieve through his guidance and through his, what we say, words, both. Practical guidance, spiritual intelligence, both. Not just one. Just like some people say, well, you know, I can study the books, and I have a, you know, I associate with devotees. But who's going to guide you? Who's going to tell you this is wrong and this is correct? You're a nonsense. We don't like that when somebody tells you we're a nonsense. But you need it. Because Prabhupada says, anyone who comes to the material world, and the Shastras say, is simply an offender to Krishna. So the fact that we're in this material world shows that we have done something wrong. So that's why this material world is called a prison house. Because at one point, we rejected Krishna, and here we are. So we're punishable. And that's called material life. Material life is a punishment. So to get out of that punishment, one needs the connection with Krishna's representative, a guru. Any questions why you need a guru before I move on to the next session? Yes. This is specific, why we need a guru.
On this topic of why you need a guru, what if someone sometimes people like have a vision of the Lord before they're actually connected to an entity in this life. How do we explain that?
Well, that's possible, but the many examples that are there, that those who have visions of the Lord tells them, get a guru. Because Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Tadviri pratipatena pariprasyena sevaya upadeksyanti te jnanam jnaninas tadvadarsha. So, yeah, many persons can connect with Krishna, but Krishna says, if you want to connect with me fully, then you have to follow the process. So there have been many persons who have had revelations, but the revelation is you need a teacher. That revelation doesn't keep you going. What keeps you going is your connection with Krishna through what is called service. Service, devotional service, is the means to connect with Krishna. Karma, yoga, is simply working for Krishna and giving up the results. So you have a job, you do something, you give some results to Krishna. Or you might use your occupation to serve Krishna in that way. Take a little for yourself, give some to Krishna. That's karma yoga. Jnana yoga means through meditation, through study of scriptures, and through detachment and various penances and austerities, one realizes they're not this body and tries to merge into the, what we say, the Brahman effulgence. They also have gurus, the jnanis. The jnanis also have gurus. But bhakti yoga means, as Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Vedaischa shaham aham eva vedyo, Vedanta krit veda vid eva chaham. The goal of all Vedic knowledge is to know me. That's the goal. There's no second goal. Second goals are supportive of the first goal. Just like if you are going on a trip long distance, you may stop at a friend's house on the way. So that may be a secondary goal, but the goal is to get to your destination. So there's intermediate goals that we achieve in the process of devotional service. But the ultimate goal is prema pumartha mahan, develop love of Krishna. Because anything less than that cannot satisfy the soul. That's the point. The soul cannot be satisfied anything less than love, pure love for Krishna. What is that verse? Savai pum som paro dharmo yato bhakti ahogsa jai. Ahoituki apriyata yayatma supersediti. This verse, Prabhupada would quote often and give a lot of classes on it, that unless one is engaged in devotional service, ahaituki apriyata, there's no question of complete satisfaction. So what is ahaituki? Means without interruption. Apriyata means without motivation. So only then can the soul be satisfied, because the soul does not belong to this world. The soul does not belong to this world. So we belong with Krishna in the spiritual world. So the soul's satisfaction comes only with contact with Krishna. And that contact is through devotional service. There's no other way. Krishna is not jnana vatsal, karma vatsal, yoga vatsal. He is bhakti vatsal. He's only attracted by bhakti, that's all. You can't attract Krishna no other way. Only by love, that's all. And love means to serve, that's all. So the spiritual master is that representative of the Lord who teaches the process of how to serve the Lord and guides one in the process of serving the Lord. Like that. So what was your question again? I forgot. I think I got
it. The question was, how does, what if one claims to have like a vision of the Lord before he's connected with an entity in this life?
Visions can't keep you going. I mean, constant vision is samadhi. But intermittent vision means you get out and again. That's a rare soul who actually has, you know, steady visions. That means in previous lifetimes, they've had spiritual masters, they have done exemplary devotional service, they are now in this world for some other reason. Either they have a tinge of material desire left, or they've come into this world on behalf of the Lord to do the Lord's work. Usually talking about people of that nature. Like that. Yes. Why? This is the subject, is why we need a guru. That's all. Okay.
In Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Lila, chapter 15, Lord Chaitanya instructs Satyaraj Khan, and he says, simply by chanting the holy name of Krishna once, a person is relieved from all the reactions of a sinful life. One can complete the 9 process of devotional service simply by chanting the holy name.
Mm-hmm.
One does not have to undergo initiation or execute the activities required before initiation.
Mm-hmm.
One simply has to vibrate the holy name with his lips.
Mm-hmm.
Thus, even a man in the lowest class, chandala, can be delivered. So,
yeah, that's a good point. That point's been brought up many times before. That there's no need for initiation. Let me just chant the holy names of the Lord, right? But the problem is, in Kali Yuga, you can't chant constantly. If you can chant constantly, then you're fixed. Just like the third stage of bhakti by Srila Rupa Goswami is, Adau Shraddha Sadhu Sangha Bhajana Kriya. Bhajana Kriya means to take shelter of Krishna's representative. So, as Prabhupada writes in this one verse from the Bhagavad Gita, the nature's system of existence, the activities are a perplexity for everyone. So without personal guidance, it's easy, or not easy, it's natural to fall away from the process of spiritual life. And we even see that even those who have spiritual masters, they struggle. What to speak of someone who doesn't struggle, or who doesn't have a spiritual master. So that verse needs to be qualified. In other words, the holy name doesn't require initiation. That's true. But Prabhupada has explained that verse in relationship to the age of Kali, that in this age, no one can come to that platform of execution. Or we might say a few people can do it. But the majority, the large majority of the population requires guidance. And like that. So that doesn't take anything away from the holy name like that. Because you'll see that initiation is in two phases. And what is the first initiation? It's called Harinam initiation. The second one is Brahminical initiation. Before Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati came, there was only one initiation. That was Brahminical initiation. Harinam initiation is quite recent because people couldn't even come up to the standard of Brahminical. So unless you have Brahminical qualities, you can't worship the Lord, really. The Lord will not accept qualities in the mode of passion and ignorance. Any qualities that are within the mode of passion and ignorance are not offerable to the Lord. One has to act in the mode of goodness. So Brahminical qualities are the only standard for execution of devotional service. Well, how can we do devotional service if we're not on the stage of Brahminical qualities? So here's the point. The spiritual master is, and therefore he takes your mixed devotion, which is full of the passion and ignorance, and offers to Krishna. And then Krishna accepts your service through the medium of the spiritual master. That's why when we offer prasadam on the altar, what do? The spiritual master is the person who is taking it and offering to Krishna. We can't approach Krishna directly. He's too pure for us. We have to go through one who is also pure like that. So that's the point. Yeah, thank you. Himanshu, you had a follow-up point?
Maharaj, it's based on the answer you gave to Siddharth Prabhu's question, it's becoming clear to me that the the prime importance of having a spiritual master is to have practical guidance in our life. So my question is, in our institution, most of us don't always get to see our spiritual masters.
Well, that's your fault.
I'm sorry?
That's your fault. Make a point to. If you want it bad enough, you can do it. Well, you might say, well, because of the worldwide society, I'm here. He doesn't come here so often. Therefore, we have communications called email, telephones. What else? It's Facebook. So many things. Now the age of communication is so complete. You can talk to anybody, anytime, anywhere. Right? It's just the way it is. So, yeah. So that's a common complaint that I'm so far away from my guru. But then again, the guru also, we'll talk about this also, that the guru recommends, and every guru recommends, that their disciples take shelter of someone in the local area who can give them guidance also, who is also aligned with his teachings. In other words, his God brothers, like that. So one and one is two. No, I'm sorry. Two and two is four. Three and one is four.
I was more interested in learning about the nature of sincerity in this regard, because it seems to me that someone may not have much association with the spiritual master but can make a lot of advancement, and someone may be getting a lot of guidance and be making very slow advancement. So what does it mean to take the spiritual master to heart?
It means to take his instructions as foremost. And if there's need for clarification, one must do that. One must hear the instruction. There's two kinds of instruction. The general instructions, which are there in his words and in his books. And then there's specific instructions as far as practical guidance. And also, he may also give spiritual instructions on a personal level too. Like that. So, if we're eager enough, we'll get everything we need. If we're not, if we just allow things to happen, then we'll remain neophyte. Have to be eager for this. Okay, Derek? Okay, now the question is still, what is a guru? We're not getting off the main subject now. If it's not about what is a guru, don't ask.
It's on the necessity of accepting a guru. So
that we'll talk about.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we have to. There are many subjects, so we'll have to take them one at a time.
Sorry, the necessity to accept a guru, Maharaj? Is the question?
What is a guru? Why do we need a guru? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Because, thanks, Maharaj. Harish.
Yeah, okay. You're on.
I was reading the Srimad Bhagavatam, first canto, chapter 15. And there is an analogy of Srila Prabhupada about a plane. So if you are flying a plane, you cannot take care of other planes.
Right.
And probably in the air, you have dangers.
Mm-hmm.
No? So in the same way, at the end of the life, you have to fly alone, something like that.
You have to fly your own plane.
Yes. So my question is, finally, is what is the function of the guru?
No? He teaches you how to fly.
Yeah, but it seems like at the end you don't need. Maybe
he also
it's an
gives
argument.
You a credit card so you can fill up on gas too. He gives you everything. Okay. Yeah, he's going to tell you exactly what you need to do. And he sometimes even provides the facility to help you do it. But ultimately, you have to fly your own plane. Because what that means at the time of death, it's just you and Krishna. So if you forget your instructions of the spiritual master at that time, that means you didn't really take the flying lessons completely. So he's preparing you for the final moment. And so the whole life is to prepare you for death. That's the life is meant to prepare us for death. So when you're fully equipped with all the, you know, requirements, then when death comes, which is the real test, you know, then you pass. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Yes, the necessity of accepting a guru.
I was wondering particularly the necessity of accepting a Diksha Guru when we may be getting Siksha from so many sources.
Tad vigyartam gurum eva abhigacche. I got the verse here. I'll read the verse. Somewhere here. Tad vigyartam sa gurum abhigacche samit pani srotyam brahmanishtam. To understand things properly, one must humbly approach with firewood in hand a spiritual master who is learned in the Vedas and firmly devoted to the Absolute Truth. That's from the Mundaka Upanishads, like that. So Prabhupada would quote this verse and say the word, abhigacche, is not a small word. It means must. One must accept Krishna's representative in the form of a guru. Krishna is coming in the form of the spiritual master. So the guru is the, what we say, representative of Krishna in this material world, who does two things. He practices his own spiritual life, and at the same time he teaches others how to do the same. So he's an example. He's acharya, means one who teaches by example. Not that he just speaks and says one thing and does something else. So Krishna has come in the form of the spiritual master. Therefore, what was your question again? Huh? Yeah, that person connects you to the parampara. The Shiksha Guru and Diksha Guru, it's also mentioned here. Let me just read the actual verse I can give you here. The instructing spiritual master and the initiating spiritual master are two aspects of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. From Chaitanya Charitamrita Adi Lila, chapter 1, verse 46. Prabhupada says, two aspects of the Godhead, instructing and initiating, like that. They're equally. Now, the question is, an instructing spiritual master can become your initiating spiritual master if they're qualified. But you can have many instructing spiritual masters, but you only have one initiating spiritual master. And there's two kinds of instructing spiritual masters. One is a liberated soul fully absorbed in devotional service. And two, one who invokes the disciple's spiritual instructions, spiritual guidance by relevant instructions. Like that. So, a person who is fixed in devotional service with no apparent position can also be, with the approval of your Diksha Guru, your instructing spiritual master. Generally, the way ISKCON is set up, the instructing spiritual master many times is someone who is a senior devotee in the temple, or even the temple president, like that. Or they could be someone who is not located in your area, but someone you have contact with. So instructors may be many, Diksha maybe is only one, like that. But instructing spiritual masters are not necessary unless you need it. And basically, we need it because of that question that was given before, that we're not always in contact with our Diksha Guru. So, therefore, I always recommend my disciples to put themselves under a qualified senior devotee and get guidance. Otherwise, they don't really know what they're doing. When the spiritual master's not around, he's not observing their behavior and their activities, they get off. It's just natural because the way the material energy is. And Shiva Ram Maharaj has written a nice book called Shiksha Guru. Have you seen that? It's really a small book. And in the book, he really explains that he would like to see Shiksha formalized in ISKCON, where there are designated Shiksha Gurus who get honor as that. And that way, a Shiksha Guru will take his service very seriously as a position, and not just someone who is doing it occasionally or whenever the disciple comes like that. Try to understand this point. Spiritual life is very, very subtle. And unless we have careful guidance or someone we can go to for questions and guidance, it's easy to get off. It's not easy, it's just natural to get off. So a Shiksha is someone that I think is very much required in our ISKCON, especially in Kali Yuga, like that. Question. Hare Krishna. Shivani, right?
Shivani,
yes, Shivani. Okay.
So I would appreciate if you can speak a little bit more on the necessity of accepting a living guru, because, like, as you just said,
there's no dead guru.
Yeah, I mean, who is present on the planet? Because
a guru who's dead is not a guru.
Yes, Maharaj. Sorry, living guru means who is like on the planet right now. Because I was just thinking when you mentioned that.
All right, so you can get initiation from Rupa Goswami. How are you going to do it? I mean, people say that. And that's the whole idea, that, you know, you can take initiation from anyone from the past. But no. Therefore, you need a Diksha Guru. Diksha Gurus are essential. I think I made that point many times. Here. One cannot become a devotee by one's personal endeavor. Just like some rascals say, what is the excuse of accepting guru? Of course they have many bad experiences. So they say, let me take someone who's not around anymore. And that way I can do what I want and I have a guru. And you usually, you know, in my personal experience, and this is the personal experience of a lot of my God brothers, when people who are like that, they're really not doing much service. They're not fully engaged in service. A spiritual master is meant to engage you completely in devotional service according to your position, whether it's grihastha or brahmachari or whatever like that. So unless there is, you know, Prabhupada said, unless someone is there to pull your ear, you're not going to pull it yourself. Because you don't like it. You just don't like it. Right? So, yeah, therefore, you know, this idea of taking someone who has disappeared from the planet has never been authorized, nor did Prabhupada authorize it. If he would authorize it, he would have talked about it. He never talked about it. And that's not a small thing. That's a big thing. If he would have talked about it, he would have gave classes on it. He never talked about that. He always said, you must take a living guru in order, you must connect yourself with the parampara, like that.
But Maharaj, how will we argue with someone who says, okay, I am not seeing my spiritual master. Anyways, I am under the shelter of his, like, vani, like his instructions. or I am under the care of a senior disciple of my spiritual master or a senior devotee in the temple. So in that ways, I don't need a living personality of my spiritual master. His instructions or senior devotees are well enough to train
me. Someone else is living, right? They're also living. You're taking shelter of someone else who's a living person. As long, and then Rupa Goswami, in Nectar of Devotion, mentions the 64 items of practice. And what is the first one? Adau Guru Vastakam. The first one is to take shelter of Krishna's representative. The second stage is to get initiation. So you need shelter. Everyone needs shelter like that. Without the shelter, when things get rough, what are you going to do? The spiritual master is meant to purify your existence by giving you instructions that are a little difficult to carry out. And that's necessary. Nobody's going to put themselves in difficulty by themselves. I mean, there's a few rare persons who do that. But even if they do, who says that kind of difficulty that they're being put in is actually benefit for them? It's something they've created. So when Prabhupada was asked, "Do you know everything?" He said, "I am not Krishna. But I know what I need to know." And what does that mean? I know how to guide my disciples. That's the empowerment the spiritual master has. He has that feature. He knows what's best for his disciples, even if the disciples don't know what's best for them, which is usually the case. So you have to have a living guru. Now, you may take instructions from so many other people, but ultimately, one has to take shelter of a spiritual master. So in the beginning, we do that. We might get instructions from so many different types of people, engage in devotional service. But then again, there has to be that formal, what we say, connection. And that formal connection keeps you connected despite what happens in the future. It has to be there. Because Krishna, it's not like this system has been given by, Krishna set up the system. Krishna says, if you want to approach me, you have to approach me through my representative. And this system of initiation is the system authorized by the great acharyas, and it's given by Krishna himself. Like that. Okay, so let's go on to the next topic, the different kinds of gurus. I think we hit about it a little bit. Okay, so there's three kinds of gurus. I'll just mention them. There is Shiksha Guru, Diksha Guru, Vartma Pradakshina Guru. So what is Vartma Pradakshina Guru? How many of you were walking down the street and got a book, and that was your first contact with devotees? Do you remember that person? That's your Vartma Pradakshina Guru. The first person it's the person who shows the way. Example in Shastra is the mother of Dhruva Maharaj. Dhruva Maharaj wanted to find God. His mother said, "Go to the forest." She guided him in the direction where he could find the Lord. So one who shows the way, that is called Vartma Pradakshina Guru, like that. Could be a book distributor, could be your friend. But there's a kind of dedication to that person, because that person was sent by Krishna to bring you to the path of bhakti. So there's no formal worship with that type of guru, but there's a sense of appreciation. And it's just a function, that's all. Like that. The first person I ever met, I don't even remember. Because it was back in 1970, and it was at an anti-war rally in Washington, D.C., and some Mataji came up with me and gave me some incense and a little book. And so she was the one that planted the seed. And I don't even remember what she looks like. I don't remember her name, nothing. So that's the person who connects you with the path. That's like that. Shiksha Guru, one who gives instructions. Diksha Guru, one who would guide you. Now, Diksha is also Shiksha. Diksha is also Shiksha. Good Diksha, what's the function of Diksha? Is Shiksha. Shiksha means instruction. So the Diksha Guru is giving you instructions. But you can also get the same instructions or support for the same instructions from others. Like that. So Shiksha and Guru Diksha are the two features of the Supreme Lord like that. So, like that. Prabhu means Lord. Prabhupada means position. One who has the position of representing the Lord, like that. Spiritual master is called Asraya Vigraha, the manifestation of the Lord of whom we must take shelter, like that. Okay, any questions on Shiksha or Diksha Guru, like that? Yes. What's the difference? What's the functions?
Actually, I wanted to know, where is Prabhupada in this three types of guru? Like, is he the Diksha? Because we are not taking initiation from Prabhupada, so he's not the Diksha guru.
He has a unique position. He's our Shiksha. He's our main Shiksha. He's everyone's main Shiksha. And he's also the founder of Acharya, which means that his teachings will be the law books for as long as, the time exists. So anyone who comes into ISKCON will have Prabhupada as the founder of Acharya. He's the person who has been empowered by the Lord to bring about religious principles in the world like that. Ramanujacharya is the founder of Acharya. Madhvacharya, founder of Acharya. Srila Prabhupada Bhaktisiddhanta founded the Gaudiya Math, like that. These are founder Acharyas. They have a special, unique position in that everyone has a relationship with them directly through the process they give. In other words, anyone who comes into the Gaudiya Math must follow Bhaktisiddhanta's teachings. And they also have a relationship with him as their main Shiksha, like that. So everyone who comes into this movement has Prabhupada as their Shiksha Guru, like that. If you read his books, you're getting Shiksha, you're getting Prabhupada, like that. But he is an extra feature because he is the founder of Acharya. Therefore, everywhere you go, within the society of ISKCON, all you see is Prabhupada. Because everything that we are doing, everything that we are speaking, is coming from him. So Prabhupada consciousness is Krishna, is Krishna consciousness in our society. He's everywhere. He's within everything. He's without. There's nothing that's not connected with Prabhupada like that. Does that answer your question? You look a little puzzled yet. You want to clarify?
It's when someone is new to ISKCON, how will he approach? First, he will be given a book, so he will obviously read the book and understand it, try to understand it. So he will get an understanding of who is Prabhupada, what did he write, and what is he saying. And then how does he see a Diksha Guru and a Prabhupada? Like, my question is like, how to see a Diksha Guru and Prabhupada? So,
yeah, he has Diksha Guru and he has Prabhupada as the founder Acharya. And Prabhupada is his main Shiksha Guru. Shiksha means instructions. Diksha also means instructions, but one who connects you to the parampara. Does that answer your question?
Okay.
Yeah. He has to have a Diksha Guru eventually. Not immediately, but eventually. So, in finding a Diksha Guru, is that what you're asking?
Not really finding, but trying to get the connection, like between Prabhupada and...
The Diksha Guru represents Prabhupada. If he's not representing Prabhupada, he's not a bona fide Diksha Guru. He speaks what Prabhupada speaks. He practices what Prabhupada teaches. He's a Prabhupada man. He lives and breathes Prabhupada. That's your Diksha Guru. If he's not, then he blocks your connection with Prabhupada through his own, what we say, inability to connect with Prabhupada. He has to be a transparent medium to Prabhupada. But Prabhupada also says, anyone who comes in my movement has a direct relationship with me, automatically. The guru, the Diksha Guru, who is a disciple of Prabhupada, enhances that relationship and builds it like that.
So, when we want to hear something, when we want to get knowledge,
you can get knowledge from so many places.
So should we first listen to Prabhupada lectures and then
get you inspired? You can do both. What is this, first or second? You can do both. You listen to your guru, listen to Prabhupada. It's all one. It's one in the sense that you're getting transcendental knowledge from different sources. Who is the only source of transcendental knowledge?
Krishna,
all right. So Krishna manifests himself in so many ways. And they're all sources of his knowledge coming in different mediums. That's all. So why are you making such a distinction?
Okay.
All right?
Okay.
Okay. Now make it simple. You're complicating something really simple. It's so simple. If I say what Prabhupada's saying, isn't that Prabhupada? Right? If Prabhupada says this and I repeat it, am I saying my opinion or am I saying Prabhupada? I'm saying Prabhupada. So it's not my opinion, it's Prabhupada. It's very simple. We shouldn't complicate something simple. The spiritual master is representing Prabhupada, what he says. If he's saying exactly what Prabhupada's saying, you're getting Prabhupada through him. And you could get Prabhupada directly by reading his books. The mediums may be slightly different, the message is the same. Yes.
There's an online question from Advaita Charan. You know Advaita Charan Prabhu from Champaign?
Okay.
He wants to know about the Shravanam Guru. He says, we also hear about Shravanam Guru, meaning whose instructions we get inspiration from, but they are different from Shiksha Guru. And generally
What kind of guru is that?
A Shravanam Guru.
Shravanam means to hear.
Yes, you hear from, but you don't necessarily get direct guidance from.
Well, those instructions are what you get from his Bhakya, right?
Yes.
Either his written or his spoken, right?
Yes.
Okay.
So he says, although we hear that we can have multiple Shiksha Gurus, it's usually the case in history that devotees have one Shiksha Guru and the others are generally Shravanam Gurus.
Yeah.
So how do we understand this topic?
Okay. It says that if any shiksha says anything different than what your diksha is saying, then you have to reject shiksha. So therefore, how do you understand it? You have to run by, check with your diksha guru what instructions and guidance you get from a shiksha guru. Now, if you know it's the same, there's no need to check. But if there's some question, then you should check. So that's mentioned in the Shastras, that when it comes to diksha and shiksha, if there's a difference, one must take diksha. So Shravanam Guru must support, you know, diksha guru. All the shikshas must support diksha. They can't be contrary. They can be supportive. Just like the spirit, just like Prabhupada would give a topic. Now, if somebody takes Prabhupada's instructions and explains it in another way without changing the essence, that's shiksha. And that's perfect. That's something we want. Okay? But if someone is giving something slightly different, then the question comes, well, my Guru Maharaj said this, and then I'm hearing this. Let me check it with my spiritual master and see how to understand it. And I know, and from a practical point of view, if my disciples say no on others, there are certain persons that I would not approve my disciples, although they're in good standing, they're Prabhupada disciples, they're gurus themselves, but they have a different mood. If the mood is different, then there can be also some confusion there. So generally we take shiksha, which has a similar mood to our diksha guru, like that. The mood of engagement in bhakti.
So before you told that everyone is following Prabhupada and everyone is following the same path, that they're guiding us toward Krishna.
Yeah.
So what is that mood then? How can the mood be different?
Well, the mood of devotional service means what they're focusing on, like that. Just like some focus on, you know, hearing and chanting, others focus on practical service. Others are focusing on maybe in a preaching sense, people focus on different ways of preaching. Some people preach, you know, like very direct. Others preach a little less direct, like that. So the mood, you know. So there's a certain, just like Prabhupada, when Prabhupada was asked, when Prabhupada was sick in 1967, and there was a chance that Prabhupada wouldn't be coming back from India after going to India to get medical treatment, Mukunda, who is now Mukunda Maharaj, asked the question. It was a very, very emotional response by Prabhupada. He said, you know, if you don't come back, Prabhupada, should we find another spiritual master to get guidance from, like one of your god brothers, like that? That was the essence of the question. Prabhupada's mood became pensive, and then it changed into a very tense moment. And there was a tear in Prabhupada's eye. And as he looked away out the window, away from Mukunda, and then he came back and he spoke, "My spiritual master saved me." And he said, if he says one thing different, you'll be confused. So therefore, in aligning the shiksha, finding a shiksha, you should align it with the similar nature as your spiritual master. Or one who is somewhat what we say in the same mood as your spiritual master. If you can't understand mood, you just have to observe the person, that's all. By watching the person, you understand the moods like that. Okay. Devotional service is very, very dynamic, and there are different personalities and different moods. So in order to keep the faith in the Diksha Guru, a Diksha Guru will not put his, or not allow his disciples to take shelter of a Shiksha who may express a completely opposite mood in the process of devotional service. It's just the way it is. Does that make sense? The ladies all know this. Can't you guys get it? It's very simple. Sorry if I didn't want to chastise everybody. But the point is, you know, the mood. When you get married, you look for someone who is a similar mood, right? Right? If you marry a Brahmin with a Kshatriya, you're going to have problems. Moods have to be similar, especially when it's coming to giving instructions like that. Now, one may get practical instructions without taking shiksha from a person. That you can get anywhere at any time. You can even get instructions from a non-devotee. A non-devotee may also give you relevant instructions. As Prabhupada would say, you can take gold from a filthy place. If a non-devotee says something that your spiritual master has said, then that's your spiritual master coming through the non-devotee. Example, Bilvamangala Thakur. Bilvamangala Thakur was attached to a prostitute, very attached. Her name was Chintamani. She was a very high-class personality with all good qualities. And, you know, he would, one night, he crossed a raging river in the middle of a storm. Her doors were locked. He climbed the wall. In other words, he went through great efforts to get to Chintamani that night. When he practically fell on the floor, he was like tired, soaking wet. He was in a mess when he came. When she saw him, she was astonished, more like disgusted. She said to him, "If you had as much love for Krishna as you had for this body," referring to herself, "you would be successful," something like that. But it wasn't her speaking. It wasn't her speaking. It was his spiritual master from a previous life, Somagiri, who spoke through the prostitute. Therefore, when he writes his prayers, Brahma Samhita, Krishna Karnamrita, he explains that my guru was Somagiri, and my instructing guru was Chintamani. He accepted Chintamani as an instructing guru because she pointed the way away from, you know, material life towards spiritual life. And after that, he became serious and he went to Vrindavan. But it wasn't her speaking. She just became the medium for his guru. So it says that if a disciple really learns the instructions of his spiritual master completely, he will see and hear those instructions in various mediums throughout the day. Because Krishna will remind that person of what they need to be reminded through various mediums like that. In fact, we're being reminded all the time. The question is, can we hear it like that? Can we connect with it? So, in the 11th canto, there's the story of the Avanti Brahmana, who had 25 gurus, and one of them was a prostitute, Pingala. And he had a dog, a sky, a mountain. There's 25 spiritual masters, and he was learning something from each and every one of them. So that's a different kind of guru. But ultimately, whoever brings you closer to Krishna consciousness, in one sense, is acting in the role of a spiritual guide like that. Formally, there is shiksha and diksha, but others are also supporting shiksha and diksha through their contact with you in different ways like that. sincere disciple is never separated from his spiritual master because they're always hearing the instructions through various mediums like that. Was a question on Sri Devi? We're going to give you a microphone.
I was wanting to know about the position of the guru when we say we have the threefold system of checks and balances, guru, sadhu, and shastra.
Yeah.
Are they all equal or there's a foremost and like that?
Shastra's foremost. Guru teaches on the basis of shastra. Sadhu confirms what's in what the guru says and what's in shastra.
So can we directly get instructions from the shastra and dispense
no.
with...
No, because you'll read what you want to read and take what you want to take, or you understand what you can understand. Therefore, the spiritual master needs to explain it for you. And then you can become more versed in understanding shastras by the guidance and instructions of your own spiritual master. He'll help you understand shastra, but he'll also explain shastra too.
But what if I say I understand the shastra perfectly, I know what to do?
Then you have to show it by your example. If you just talk about it, you know, you got to walk your talk. As they say, got to walk your talk. If you talk, then walk it. That's called acharya, or one who speaks and acts in the same way. So if you know shastra, you have to show it by your example. Right? Anybody can say anything. Prabhupada said, a madman will say anything, a goat will eat anything. Go, Willie, right? Ah, yes. Okay. Acharya Nishta also had a question, right?
Thank you, Maharaj. On the last story about Prabhupada that you told, I was wondering, just for our understanding, what was Prabhupada's opinion of his disciples hearing from his godbrothers? Was it general discouraged, or there was some that he...
He always discouraged. But one time, there's a few examples where he pointed to Sridhar Maharaj and said that he is very elevated. And that's when devotees went to India the first time back in the 60s. And Prabhupada wasn't there. He said you could stay with Sridhar Maharaj. They also stayed with Madhava Maharaj too. But later, Prabhupada had some problems with that. But Sridhar Maharaj, Prabhupada, you know, saw him, you know, as a very, very senior godbrother. Prabhupada would also get guidance from Sridhar Maharaj like that. So, like that.
And one other question was, it's explained one should not compare, one should not try to see
one's guru against another guru?
Because the guru is a manifestation of Krishna, as you were saying. Mm-hmm. So, at the same time, some may be particularly empowered, but one is not supposed to distinguish. Is that correct?
Well, you should always see your guru as the best. Because if you don't, you're going to have a problem. It's just like if you're married and you're looking at another lady and saying, she's better than my wife. although I'm married, you better stay with your wife. I think she's the best. Okay? Otherwise, that is called cheating. So, yeah, we can see, if you have that vision, you can see the power of a certain spiritual master. It says, now this is also important to understand, it says that one should take initiation from an Uttama Arikari. So that means one who's on the highest platform. But if an Uttama Arikari is not available, one can take instructions from, or initiation from, someone who is on the Madhyam platform. That's a nectar of instructions like that. Because you need a guru. So if there's no Uttama available, you might want to wait, but they may never come. So, therefore, you can take an initiation from a Madhyama Arikari, but it says that he can only take you as far as he is. But he can also come to the Uttama platform. And that means then he becomes Uttaman also, like that. So, but it says that if you walk into the room and there are different spiritual masters sitting there, you always pay your obeisances first to your spiritual master, like that. But it says if you walk into the room and you don't have a spiritual master, you pay your obeisances to that person who is the most senior amongst them. That's Narahari Sakar. In his Bhajanamrita, he explains that. So to know the strengths of different spiritual masters, you know, is something very subtle. But if you do it in a comparative way, better or worse, then you're going to be offender. That's offensive. If you do it just for understanding, that's different. Like that. Luke has been having his hand up for a long time. Who has a question? Jai Jagannath.
The question actually has three points, and they're all kind of connected. If the shiksha will never be different, then what's the point of having a diksha guru? Of having a shiksha guru, yes, having a shiksha guru. Especially in
say that again, right? Say
if
that.
The shiksha will never be different, then what's the point of having a shiksha guru? Especially in the case where the shiksha guru is more advanced, it is expected that he may speak things which one has not heard from the diksha guru. Did Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur confirm what he received from Jagannath Das Babaji with his diksha guru?
Good question. Well, we might say, of course we don't know, that, you know, Bihari Lal, which was the Bhaktivinoda Thakur's guru, he might have gave him permission to take instructions from Jagannath Das Babaji. Actually, you have to have permission to take instructions from someone outside of your spiritual master, so there's no contrary instructions. If the shiksha is more empowered and in a better position, then he's not going to say anything different. He may give you a more understanding or even broader understanding, but it's not like the idea is not something different. Just like the spiritual master might teach you how to chant the holy name, but your shiksha guru might give you the intricacies and very detailed, what we say, aspects of the glories of the holy name in a very wonderful way, and quote very much Shastra. So both are given the same instructions, but one is simply expanding the instructions, so that's not different. If you see that as different, then you're missing the point. Different means if there's a different opinion, instruction coming from your shiksha guru, which is contrary to your diksha guru. That's all. Now the question comes back to, if you're not sure, you run it by your diksha guru. That's shastra. I'll have to get the exact shastra, but that's mentioned many times, and Shiva Ram Maharaj mentions it in his shiksha book, Shiksha Guru, like that. Diksha remains foremost, but diksha can give shiksha, give disciple over to shiksha and say, now you follow this person. So we can, I think we can naturally say that In the case of Bhaktivinod Thakur, Hari Rilal had no difficulty with Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj. In fact, Hari Rilal used to carry Jagannath Das Babaji in a basket. He was the personal servant of Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj, who later became the Diksha Guru of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So therefore, Hari Rilal was, in one sense, very much junior to Jagannath Das Babaji. So he allowed Jagannath Das Babaji to give instructions to Bhaktivinoda Thakur and become his main guru, like that. Bipin Bihari, I'm sorry. Yeah, Bipin Bihari. Yeah, I just said the word. I said the name wrong. Bipin Bihari, excuse me. Sometimes you say Bihari Lal, but it's Bipin Bihari, actually. Yeah, you're right. I mean, there's an incident where Bhaktivinoda Thakur pays obeisances to Bipin Bihari, and Bipin Bihari puts his foot on Bhaktivinoda Thakur's head in the presence of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati takes issue with Bipin Bihari and says, "You don't really know his power." because he understood, that Bhaktivinoda Thakur was even greater spiritually than his spiritual master, Bipin Bihari. So a disciple may even exceed the spiritual power of his spiritual master, but he doesn't present himself that way. He'll never present himself, because that's a guru avagya. That's an offense. But there are cases where even the disciple is more advanced than the spiritual master. And Prabhupada used to say, "I pray that I have a disciple who is more advanced than me. That way he can take me back to Godhead." That's Vaishnav humility, right? Yeah.
He has a follow-up. It says, especially in the case where his Diksha Guru did not support the location of Mayapur, which was confirmed by Jagannath Das Babaji.
So obviously there's a difference there. But it was proven by maps. It was proven Bhaktivinoda Thakur excavated or found these hidden maps that really confirmed that. So at what point did he disagree? And then later did he agree after everything was conclusive? The question is, we don't know. We'd have to know the history. But it became obvious later that all the evidence pointed to where Bhaktivinoda Thakur found, the birthplace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So the dynamics between Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Bipin Pilau is really hard to understand. From a conjecture, we can always, So there may have been some disagreement there, yeah. But Bhaktivinoda Thakur was not a small person. Not at all. He brought Lord Chaitanya's movement to the West by his transcendental vision. Okay. So, more questions. Oh, Sri Devi. We're running out of time here, right? We'll end at this. We got 9:22 now. We'll end at 9, around 9:27. So 5 more minutes.
Maharaj, what is the difference between Acharya and Guru?
There are many gurus, but there are few Acharyas. Acharyas means one who... The actual literary definition of the word Acharya means one who teaches by example. Acharyas may be outstanding personalities within the parampara who were noted for some outstanding achievement or contribution like that. Sometimes we use the words intermittently or interchangeably, but generally acharya means one who teaches by example like that. Prabhupada said, or Lord Chaitanya said, by my command, be guru, save the land. So anyone who speaks the message of Lord Chaitanya is considered to be a guru, according to Lord Chaitanya's definition. Yadi deka kari aha Krishna upadesh. So he told the Korma Brahma, everyone you meet, tell them about Krishna, and then you are a guru, like that. But acharya is different. He's one who establishes, you know, a principle, parampara like that. There are many acharyas like that. Gurus are many, acharyas are few.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Okay. So I'm going to really quickly mention something, because the guru is one because he comes in disciplic succession. What Vyasadeva and Krishna taught 5,000 years ago is also being taught now. So this is the point, guru is one. There is no difference between the two instructions. Although hundreds and thousands of acharyas have come and gone, the message is one. So guru is one. There's only one guru, Krishna. And anyone who acts on behalf of Krishna is a guru. Guru is one. How the guru is different in three categories. The guru is different by role. Initiating and instructing spiritual masters are equal and identical manifestations of Krishna, although they have different dealings. From Adi Lila, chapter 1, verse 34, purport. Guru is different by qualification. A person who is a liberated acharya and guru cannot make any mistake. But there are persons who are left qualified and not liberated, but still can act as guru and acharya by strictly following the disciplic succession. That's a letter by Srila Prabhupada to Janardana. So by qualification, you know, there is a difference. There's difference between guru. So guru is different by qualification, by role, and by commitment. The last one is by commitment. The spiritual master who first gives information about spiritual life is called Vartma Pradakshina Guru. The spiritual master who initiates according to the regulations of the Shastra is called Dikshara Guru. And the spiritual master who gives instructions for elevation is called Shiksha Guru. That's from Madhya Lila, chapter 8, 128, purport. So by commitment, by qualification, by role, gurus are different. So there's guru who is one, message is one. Gurus who are different by the roles they play, the qualifications they have, and the commitment to this disciple that they provide. Last one, guru is one with and different from Krishna, the Supreme Lord. Saksa Daretvan, Shakshan directly. Hari Twaina, with the quality of Hari. The spiritual masters must be honored as much as the Supreme Lord, because he is the confidential servitor of the Lord. So the guru is one with and different from the Lord. He is Krishna who is serving, there is Krishna who is being served, like that. Any questions? Guru is one, gurus are different. Yes. Say again.
I'm wondering if you are planning to share the document, Maharaj?
Yeah, I can share all the stuff I have. You just have to see me. What the best thing is to give me a stick and I'll put on your computer.
Okay.
Put on the stick and then you can put it on your computer like that.
Okay, Maharaj.
Yeah, like that. Or if you have an email address, I'll send it to you. So you can either give me an email address or a stick. Luke?
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
I was thinking in light of this latest point, how should we understand gurus and acharyas in other Vaishnava sampradayas or other
You should give them honor and Vaishnav, respect, but Vaishnav you should not movements. Hear. You should not hear from them. You should give them honor and respect. Yeah. Yeah, they're very powerful personalities, very dear to Krishna, but they're presenting the message in a certain way, like that. Okay, so do one. Well, I don't want to keep the devotees from taking prasadam. It's 9:28 and we have to get back at 11 for the next session. So I will say, anyone who would like to leave, please feel free to go. And if you want to give me the questions, I'll be happy to take them. So don't feel obligated to stay.
The first online question is from Sri Gauranga Prabhu. He says, Hare Krishna Maharaj, is there a role of the consciousness I'm in to understand who is a sadhu around me?
Is there a role of
the consciousness I am in to understand who is a sadhu around me?
Well, that begs the question, what consciousness are you in? It says that you can understand through understanding qualifications, activities. So the next session we'll talk about what are the qualifications of a spiritual master. And then through qualifications and through activities, both, when even anyone who honestly and sincerely applies these principles can understand who's a spiritual master. In most cases, not everyone. But the best way and the safest way is to get advice from others. If you are not sure, you might ask, is this person a spiritual master or not? Okay.
The other question is from Nilesh Prabhu in Indiana. He says, it is said that our Guru Parampara is more of Shiksha, then how do we understand the importance of Diksha Guru as the specific person to focus on in our life? Because there is a lot of Diksha Guru sectarianism in ISKCON when devotees get together for services.
Well, that sectarianism is not something that is bona fide. But Shiksha Guru, Diksha Guru is someone who connects you. But, you know, if you have someone who is your Shiksha Guru, who is more prominent, that guru can be there. He can be the most prominent person in your life, but you still have to have a Diksha Guru to connect you to the parampara. That's the whole thing. Your Shiksha Guru may be your main guru, or the person you get instructions from, but the Diksha Guru still has to be there. So our line is Shiksha because these persons are mentioned as outstanding. You know, Jagannath Das Babaji and Bhakti Vinod Thakur is the prime example. Our line is generally Shiksha, yeah. But Diksha still has to be there because to connect one with the parampara, although the Diksha Guru may not be their prominent guru. I know, it is in some cases, even with me, there are certain disciples of mine who have Shiksha Gurus who are more prominent in their relationship with them than myself. And that's fine.
Last question online. Since the system of Harinam Diksha is recent, is the Diksha Guru defined by the one who gives Brahminical initiation? In the case that the two gurus are different, then how do we understand and distinguish?
Well, Prabhupada said Brahminical initiation is the real initiation. Harinam is just what connects you to the parampara. Because in this age, Harinam has been given as a form of initiation to prepare you for the real initiation, which is Brahminical initiation. So someone asked Prabhupada, can you go back home, back to Godhead without taking Brahminical initiation? Prabhupada said, it is required. Because if you read the Shastras very carefully, you'll see that the Guru would give the Upanaya some scar, which is the Brahminical thread. There's no mention of Harinam initiation. That's something that's been new because of Kali Yuga, that's all. So we might say that the Brahminical initiation, it's like you have two spiritual masters, that's all. But you must take Brahminical initiation. It's required. Oh, so, another question.
That's the last follow-up question. It is a short question.
I'm fine, but anybody can leave if they want to. Don't feel obligated if you're hungry. Want to take lunch or breakfast? Yeah.
So from your last answer, can we conclude that it is mandatory for everyone to take Brahminical initiation in our movement?
That's what Prabhupada said. And I usually send out a communique on my website all the time mentioning that. Prabhupada said, yeah. He said, I can give you the exact quote. It's mentioned in the Shastra too. He actually writes it, that Brahminical initiation is the complete initiation. The first initiation connects you with the spiritual master. He takes part of your karma. The second one is that all the karma is absolved on the second initiation. Because Brahminical initiation means you have developed the qualities of a Brahmana, and therefore you're qualified to worship the Lord. Like that. Become qualified. Yes. Yes, Shivani.
It's important to take Brahman initiation, as Prabhupada also
mentioned.
It's
mandatory.
It's mandatory. So
yeah. I'll get the quote and I'll give it to you in the next session.
So sometimes we have observed that some devotees have taken Harinam initiation and then their guru had left the planet, so they had taken initiation from someone else.
That's fine.
So whom do we consider real guru? I mean,
both.
So who is going to take you back to Godhead, the Harinam guru or the...
Guru is one. Why are you making this? Two people are doing the same function, therefore guru is one.
But how do we understand this, Maharaj? I mean,
there's only one guru, it's Krishna. He comes in different forms to perform different functions for the disciples' elevation. Shiksha, Diksha, this, you know, like that.
So like sometimes, like we hear that guru has the responsibility to take the disciples back to Godhead. So if you are not able to follow, like complete the process in this lifetime, guru is eternal, so he has to come back in that ways. Who is going to, like, out of the two, who is going to? I mean, it can be funny.
They can talk about it and see which one wants to come. The person who gives you first initiation is your spiritual master. The second one who is doing the Brahminical initiation, he's just assisting your spiritual master in the process. But he's completing the process for your spiritual master, because although the spiritual master's gone, the function is still necessary. So your first person is your spiritual master. But the second one is also, but he's just an adjunct. He's an added person who's, so the first person you connect to, that's your spiritual master. Okay, I'm sorry I told a joke there. Well, that's the point. It's the first one you take initiation from. He's just assisting and doing the complete, like that. I mean, I can tell you a really interesting story. You want to hear a really interesting story? One person was aspiring for me for a long time. Finally, she met Sridhar Swami. And then she really was inspired for Sridhar Swami. So, but she felt that she didn't want to disappoint me when she wanted to take initiation from Sridhar Swami. And Sridhar Swami really connected with her. So she finally, you know, gave her heart to Sridhar Swami without telling me. And then what happened was he left the planet. So then she was confused. She didn't know what to do. So she went to another guru in ISKCON, took initiation from that person, not from me. And he told me that her spiritual master is Sridhar Swami. So he did the work on behalf of Sridhar Swami. If she would have came to me, I would have did the work on behalf of Sridhar Swami. That person you give your heart to as your spiritual master is your spiritual master. Okay? Like that. Because it's the heart connection. The formal initiation just consummates what's already in the heart. Like that. Okay. Yes, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Thank you for your class. I appreciate the comment that you said that Prabhupada said that Ramanical initiations require going back to Godhead. Now, what happens if, let's say, I guess it's a hypothetical question, a Prabhupada disciple only got first initiation and Prabhupada left the earth, and he knows about going back to Godhead? What is
Prabhupada's his guru. Prabhupada is his spiritual master, so he takes a second initiation from someone else who does the work on behalf of Prabhupada, and Prabhupada's his spiritual master. That's not hypothetical. That happens all the time.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Hope to see you all at 11 o'clock.